so much, Mr. Vince. What a wonderful job, as always. At this time, our kids are headed to Children's Church. So if you would like to head to Children's Church, you can head on out now. Looks like they're excited. Let me just begin by sharing with you how appreciative I am of you all and all that you do. And so many people play such an important role here in our church, but everybody plays a part in what God is doing here. And so let me just share a report with you. If you haven't heard, this past Wednesday night, we had 106 in our Awana on Wednesday evening, which is an incredible number, and certainly give God praise for that. But out of that 106, we had two kids that gave their life to Christ. And, so excited about what God is doing in our midst, and excited about those two young folks that have made decisions for Christ and have started talking with their families, and so I'm looking forward to seeing how God continues to work in their lives, and so I'm excited about that. And so you played a part in that by being a part of our church here, by giving, by being a part of volunteering, and each and every one of us played an important role there, and so I just wanted to begin by saying thank you for being a part of what the Lord is doing. Last week, we began our study through the book of Philippians, and so we're going to get right back into it. So if you've got your Bible with you this morning, we'll be in the book of Philippians. Philippians chapter 1, starting in verse 12, is where we will be this morning. Philippians chapter 1, beginning in verse 12. Once you find your place there, I do invite you to stand with me if you're able, as we honor the reading of God's Word. Philippians chapter 1, beginning in verse 12. Paul writes, I want you to know, brothers, that what has happened to me has really served to advance the gospel, so that it has become known throughout the whole imperial guard and to all the rest that my imprisonment is for Christ. And most of the brothers, having become confident in the Lord by my imprisonment, are much more bold to speak the word without fear. Some indeed preach Christ from envy and rivalry, but others from goodwill. The latter do it out of love, knowing that I am put here for the defense of the gospel. The former proclaim Christ out of rivalry, not sincerely, but thinking to inflict me in my imprisonment. What then? Only that in every way, whether in pretense or in truth, Christ is proclaimed, and in that I rejoice. Yes, and I will rejoice, for I know that through your prayers and the help of the Spirit of Jesus Christ, that this will turn out for my deliverance, as it is my eager expectation and hope that I will not be at all ashamed, but that with full courage, now as always, Christ will be honored in my body, whether by life or by death. For to me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. If I am to live in the flesh, that means fruitful labor for me. Yet, which I shall choose, I cannot tell. I am hard pressed between the two. My desire is to depart and be with Christ, for that is far better. But to remain in the flesh is more necessary on your account. Convinced of this, I know that I will remain and continue with you all for your progress and joy in the faith, so that in me you may have ample cause to glory in Christ Jesus because of my coming to you again. Let's pray. God, we thank you so much, Lord, for this time that we have to be able to come together to be in your house. And Father, to hear from your word. And God, that's our desire this morning. God, we don't need to hear another message. God, the last thing we need to hear is what Paxton Redd has to say. But God, we desperately need to hear from you. So Lord, we pray that you would speak to our hearts and let us leave here changed because of what you have to say to us. And it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. You can be seated. So Paul starts off by sharing with these folks about his current condition and sharing with them that he knows that God has a plan even in the midst of his circumstances. We told you last week, if you remember, that Paul's writing the book of Philippians while he is in prison. So not the most ideal of circumstances to be sharing with someone or trying to encourage someone. But Paul, out of his situation, says that he knows that God has a plan. He gets right to it in verse 12. He says, I want you to know, brothers, that what has happened to me has really served to advance the gospel. Or some translations have the furtherance of the gospel. The idea of furtherance or advance is really, in the Greek language, that's a military term. And the military term would be what we would think of as those who would go in and prepare the way. It literally is pioneer advance. And so Paul says that these are the people who are going to go in and they're going to lay the foundation for the rest of the group to be able to come in after. And Paul says that's what my imprisonment has done. He said, even though I'm in prison, that God has used this as an advance for the gospel. Even in the midst of these terrible circumstances, he says, I see that God has a plan and that God is doing something special, even in the midst of this, that in the midst of this terrible thing, that God is moving forward. Church, I want to tell you that your struggles, that your difficulties, that your trials are a megaphone for the gospel. When you go through difficulties, when you go through trials, when you go through tough times, God is able to use those to point people to Him. You see, when we're going through trials, people begin to look at us and they begin to watch us and they begin to see how are they going to respond to this difficulty. How are they going to act when faced with a terminal disease? How are they going to act when faced with the loss of a loved one? How are they going to act in the face of the loss of a job? Or how are they going to react in this time? And so people begin to watch us. And Paul says in those moments that God can use those for the advance of the gospel in His sake, in His case. And I'm here to tell you this morning that God can do the same in your case as well. That when you're going through difficulty, whatever that difficulty might be, that people begin to watch. And when they watch, you have an opportunity to point them to Christ. And that's exactly what Paul said he has done. He says, even in the midst of this imprisonment, everybody knows that I'm here because of Christ. Verse 13, he says, so that it has become known throughout the whole imperial guard and to all the rest that my imprisonment is for Christ. He says, in all of this, I keep pointing people to Jesus. I keep pointing to Christ and all that He has done so that everyone knows the reason why I'm here is because of Jesus. Church, what would it look like in the middle of your trial, in the middle of your difficulty, for you to be able to point people to Christ? Now, each situation is obviously going to be very different. Each circumstance is going to require a different response, but what would it look like in the midst of difficulty for people to look at you and say, man, how are you getting through this? For you to be able to say, there's only one way that I've got through this. And that's because of Christ. Because of Jesus Christ. He's the only way that I've been able to get through this. He's the only reason that I've been able to make it this far. And so we just continue to point people to Christ, even in the midst of our difficulties. Paul says that it's spread like wildfire. Everybody knows. And I'm telling you that when your trials come, and they come, you know that. Some of you are probably in the middle of one now. I heard it said once that you're either coming out of a trial, you're in a trial, or you're getting ready to go into it, right? They're always right around the corner. And so when your trials come, if we point people to Christ, if we continue to live the life that He's called us to and point people to Him, I can assure you that it has a much louder effect. Much longer lasting effect than for someone who's in the middle of a great season in life. And I hope that's everybody, right? But that's just not the reality. In the middle of the good times, when we say, man, Jesus is good. Man, the Lord is good. In the middle of good times, everybody goes, yeah, of course it's good. Everything's good in your life. You don't know what it's like to go through difficulty. But when we can go through difficulty, whatever it might be, and say, the Lord is still good. He's the one that's sustaining me. He's the one that's getting me through this. Well, we can do that. And it speaks so much louder. And people begin to pay attention. Well, there must be something to that. There must be something to this gospel. There must be something to Jesus that has been able to sustain people through these difficulties. Paul says that it's spread throughout everywhere. He says in verse 14, and most of the brothers, having become confident in the Lord by my imprisonment, are much more bold to speak the word without fear. Paul says that not only has everybody heard about it, but other brothers, those who are followers of Christ, have been encouraged by Paul's imprisonment. They said, this guy's in prison and he's still sharing the gospel. Well, why is he in prison? For sharing the gospel. And yet he's still not stopped. And so they've taken courage from this. They said, you know what? Maybe we need to be a little more bold. Maybe we need to do a little more. And so others are encouraged by it. And now the gospel is getting even more influence in the world and in the time that Paul was there. So church, if you're going through a difficulty, you might be an encouragement for someone else who might be going through something similar. They may not be going through something exactly like you, but maybe something similar that as you are pointing to Christ and talking about how the Lord is getting you through and sustaining you, you might be the encouragement for them to be able to do the same thing. You might be the one that, without even knowing it, that they're watching, and you might be that encouragement for them. We never know how the Lord might use us in those moments. And so Paul says that there's a lasting effect. In verses 15 through 18, he talks about some of the other reasons that people are preaching the gospel, but he comes down to it in verse 18. He says, what then, only that in every way, whether in pretense or in truth, Christ is proclaimed, and in that I rejoice. And he says, I don't really care why people are doing things, why they're preaching, why they're sharing. He says, I'm only concerned about one thing, and that's the message of the gospel needs to get out. He said, that's my only goal. I don't care why it happens or how it happens, but I want to make sure that that's what's taking place. And so Paul says that is his aim, is to see the gospel go forward. He's got one goal, and that's to see the gospel move forward. Now, as we get over to verse 19, Paul kind of shifts gears. He's no longer talking about the advance of the gospel, but yet you can still see the focus of the advance of the gospel in his life. Because he's going to shift from talking about how this is the importance and this is the priority to begin to talk about how he's going to live this out and why it's important for him to live this out. Verse 19 says, for I know that through your prayers and the help of the Spirit of Jesus Christ, that this will turn out for my deliverance. Paul says, in other words, I'm in prison now. God has planned, God has used this. He said, and I know that through your prayers and with the help of the Holy Spirit, that this is going to lead to my deliverance. Paul says, it might not look like I'm going to get out, but deliverance doesn't always mean getting out. It doesn't always mean that I'm going to get out of prison, but I know that God's going to deliver me from this current situation. It reminds me of the story of the three Hebrew boys in the Old Testament, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. They say that we know that our God is able to deliver us from your hands, O King, but even if he doesn't, God's going to deliver us from your hands. Even if it doesn't look like how you think it would look like, we know that God's going to take care of us. And so Paul here, he says, I know that God is going to deliver me. It might not look the way that some people would expect it to look. It might not be with me getting out of prison, but I know that God is going to deliver. I think Paul very well was planning on getting out of prison to be able to come back and to be with the church of Philippi. But he knew without a doubt that either way, God was going to deliver him. How do we know that he was talking about these two different things? Just keep reading. Verse 20. As it is my eager expectation and hope that I will not be at all ashamed, but that with full courage, now as always, Christ will be honored in my body, whether by life or by death. He says, I believe that I'm going to be delivered. He says, but what I want more than anything is that through my life, whether that be through my life or whether that be through my death, that people will see that Christ has been my goal. That he's my aim, that I want it in everything that I do. I want to bring honor and glory to him, no matter what that looks like. If that's the way that I live, or if that's the way that I die, I want to bring honor to my Lord. And so we know that he's dealing with this idea of whether or not he's going to continue to be in prison or whether he's going to be delivered through his death. In verse 20, that we just read there, he tells us a really good word for all of us today. He tells us that if our goal is to make Christ known, If our aim is the advance of the gospel, like you said earlier, then our lives really don't matter all that much, do they? You see, Paul's perspective was not a selfish perspective. He wasn't at all focused on himself. He was 100% focused on the Lord. Verse 21 echoes this even more. For to me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. And Paul had a different kind of perspective here, right? Most of us would probably not want to say, for me to live is Christ and to die is gain. So what exactly does he mean by this? Well, let's unpack verse 21 by reading the next few verses. You see, Paul kind of explains for us what exactly it means to live as Christ and to die as gain. Verse 22, he says, for if I am to live in the flesh, that means fruitful labor for me. And so what does it mean to live as Christ? He says, if I am to live, then that means I've got to do something and that God's going to use what I do for fruitful labor. I don't want to just go through life and get to the end of my life and go, well, man, that was kind of a waste. He says, if I'm going to live, I want to live for something. I want to have my life to be used. I want it to be fruitful. I want it to be labor. I want God to use the work that I do to somehow, in some way, bring glory into him. So if we're going to live, he says, to live is Christ. It means we live with a purpose, right? That we've got something that we're chasing after, something that we're working towards. That fruitful labor is his goal. But not only that. He continues on. He says, yet which I shall choose, I cannot tell you. I'm hard-pressed between the two. My desire is to depart and to be with Christ, for that is far better. Again, to die is gain, right? He says, if I die, I get to be with Jesus. It doesn't get better than that. So if to die is gain, he says, I know that that's the case. But verse 24 says, but to remain in the flesh is more necessary on your account. So to live as Christ means that we're working towards something. It means fruitful labor, but it also means serving others. Because he says that if we're to live as Christ, it definitely means that fruitful labor, but it says it's also more necessary on their account. So he's serving other people. So to live as Christ means that we're working towards something. It means fruitful labor that God is going to bless and God's going to do something with. But it also means that we're serving others and we're keeping others in our mind. It's not all about us, but we're continuing to try to reach out and to help others grow in their walk with the Lord and to share the gospel with others. Verse 25 says, convinced of this, I know that I will remain and will continue with you all for your progress and joy in the faith. Paul says not only is it about serving others, but it's about helping others find their joy in following Christ. About helping others to be able to find what it looks like and how they can have the joy in the faith. What exactly is it that Paul is getting at here? To live is Christ, to die is gain. He says that there's nothing that can beat me going to be with Jesus forever. It's the greatest thing that I could ever imagine. He says, but yet, if I'm here in this life, I want there to be some fruitful labor. I want to see God using me. I don't want to just go through the motions. I want to do things and I want it to be fruitful. And not only that, but I want to serve other people and I want to keep other people in mind as I help them along in their walk with the Lord and help them grow in their faith, but also to help them find their joy. You see, Paul says that in serving the Lord, in living is Christ. He said that there is joy. You see, Paul says that if my life is 100% focused on the Lord, that I get some satisfaction out of this. I find something that cannot be taken away. I find some joy. You see, joy is not based on the circumstances of our life. Happiness comes and goes, right? But joy is a constant. It's not something that changes with our circumstances. And so if joy is something that Paul says that we can have in living for Christ and serving after him, that sounds like something that's pretty good. A pastor up in Minneapolis, he kind of put this section of scripture in his own words. And he says these words. He says, God is most glorified in us when we are most satisfied in him. Say that again. God is most glorified in us when we are most satisfied in Him. That's what to live as Christ looks like. That means that He is our one desire, that He is our goal, He is our aim. Not only are we looking to seek to advance the gospel, but we are looking to live just like He would call us to live. To live as Christ. And He closes out in verse 26 by saying, so that in me you may have ample cause to glory in Christ Jesus because of my coming to you again. Let me close with a story of a guy that I think understood exactly what Paul meant. I heard a story several years ago of a pastor who was preaching in a country where it was illegal to be a Christian. Not only illegal to be a Christian, but definitely illegal to share the gospel with anyone. And as a pastor, this man, his goal, his aim, everything about his life was to point people to Christ. And so he went about his day just like the laws didn't exist, because he thought that his call to share the gospel was more important than the law. What ended up getting this man arrested, they brought him in, beat him, told him he didn't need to share the gospel anymore, that he needed to quit this Christian thing, and they released him. Well, the man left that encounter, and he was even more emboldened to go out and share the gospel. He said, man, if this is what it's like to be persecuted for the Lord, he said, I'm all in. That is nothing compared to what I know that God has in store for me. He said, so it even more emboldened him to be able to go and share the gospel. And so he goes and he begins to share. And now that he's been arrested and beaten, people know this man really believes what he's talking about. He's not just saying this, but he actually believes it, because they beat him and he's still talking about it. And so now people are desperately wanting to hear what he has to say. And so they start a tape ministry. And so this man starts recording sermons on tapes, and they're starting to distribute them all over the area where he's at. And so the people who arrested him the first time come back and say, man, you didn't learn your lesson. So they beat him even more severely. Told him, you need to quit preaching the gospel. You need to quit this Christian thing. And they beat him and beat him and beat him bad. And released him. Well, guess what he did? He went right back to preaching and sharing the gospel. And he says, man, I want you all to know that I really believe this. And so his following grew even more because they knew what he had gone through. And so quickly they come back and they arrested him again. They brought him in and they said, obviously we can't beat you enough. They said, so we're just going to kill you. And he said, oh, praise the Lord. He said, that I would be considered worthy enough to die for my faith. He said, this is the best thing that could ever happen to me, is for you to kill me. Kind of looked at each other. They said, well, we don't want to give you what you want. He said, I wish you would. He said, because not only if you kill me, he said, I get to spend eternity with my Savior, which is what I've been living my life for. He said, this would be the best thing you could ever do for me, but not only would it be for me, but if you kill me, people will know that I died for my faith, and everybody who has one of my tapes, they would know that I actually believed it to the point of death, and this message would spread like wildfire. If you would just take my life, please, please do it. They got together and they came back after talking with one another, and they come back into the room and they said, sir, we're going to release you because we don't want to give you what you want, and we're afraid that if we do kill you, that you're right, that this message will spread like wildfire. They said, but we also know that if we release you, you're going to go back and you're going to continue to preach. And they said, we definitely don't want that. They said, but we don't know how to stop you. And they simply released the guy to be able to go back to his village to continue to share his preach. He said, that's a guy that understood, I really believe, what Paul said, to live as Christ. He says, as long as I've got breath, I'm going to give this thing everything that I've got. I'm not holding anything back. I want fruitful labor. I want God to bless what I do, and I want to serve other people because I want this message of the gospel to get out, and I want to help them grow in their faith. But if I die, man, there's nothing better than what is waiting for me. That guy got it. He understood exactly what Paul was talking about. And so my question for us this morning as we as we close our eyes. Are you living for Christ? Can you say like Paul or that pastor that with everything that you've got, you're living for the Lord? And can you say this morning that if I die, then that'll be the greatest thing that'll ever happen to me? Can you say that this morning? See, the only way that those men were able to say that was because they had full assurance of their faith. They knew that they weren't just believing in a Jesus, but they had a personal relationship with a God that came, paid the price for their sin, rose 3 days later, proving that he had conquered their sin. They had a relationship with a God that they knew was going to come through. They knew where they would spend their eternity. This morning, do you have that kind of assurance? I'm going to ask you, I'm going to beg you, please don't leave here today without having that kind of assurance in your life. Of knowing without a doubt that to die is gain. That the best part of your life comes after you die. If you don't know that for sure, do not leave here today without giving me an opportunity to talk to you. I would love to be able to share with you what Christ has done for you and the promises that he has for you. For the rest of you that have that assurance, we go back to the first question. Can you say with Paul, to live is Christ? Can we say that without hesitation, without reservations, to know that our lives are 100% sold out for him? If not, I'm going to ask you just simply to respond to whatever God is talking to you about, whatever he's laid on your heart. If you need to come and pray, if you need to come and talk to me, I'd be glad. I would be honored. But whatever it is that God is speaking to you about this morning, just be obedient to him. Let's pray together. God, we thank you. God, we thank you so much for your goodness and for your grace. And Father, this morning, we pray that God, we could say, just as Paul did, to live is Christ and to die is gain. God, to know that what comes next after this life is far better than the greatest joys that we've ever experienced. But Father, that we might not waste one single moment of this life. But God, we would continue to focus on you. And Father, how we might better serve others and point them to you. Lord, use this time for your glory. It's in Christ's name we pray. Would you stand, please?
I come to that cross, seeking mercy and grace. I come to that cross, where you died in my place. Out of my weakness and into to the cross. Your arms are open, call me by name. You welcome this child that was lost. You paid the price for my guilt and Jesus, I come. Jesus, I come. Jesus, I come to the cross. I come to the cross, seeking mercy and grace. Your arms are open. You call me by name. You have loved this child that was lost. You paid the price for my guilt and my shame. Jesus, I come. Jesus, I come to the cross.
Can you see it just for a moment? I'm excited to share with you this morning that Lucy Bailey has come desiring to follow the Lord in baptism. She says she has no hesitations and no doubts that she knows that she's saved, and she's ready to follow the Lord in that next step of obedience and be baptized. So we're excited. If you're excited, say amen.
Amen.
Working in her life. And so she's gonna come over to me with me by the door, and you guys come by and encourage her and just give you an opportunity to say how proud you are of her. And so I asked her if that was okay. She said it was okay. I'll take it easy on her. But again, we are so excited, and we'll be planning that. We'll get with you guys, and we'll schedule that baptism, and I'm excited about seeing that take place. If you're one of those that, like Lucy, said, you know what, I know without a doubt that I'm saved, but I've never made that next step of obedience by following baptism, stop at the door. We'll make plans for you to be baptized with Lucy. Let her example be a good example for you. We just talked about how what we do is a megaphone. Maybe her megaphone will speak to some of you all as well. And so maybe you need to make that decision as well. It's not too late. You still got time to do that. So again, we're certainly excited and proud of you, and we'll continue to pray for you. Again, don't forget meeting right after church this morning for youth and parents, and then the leadership team meeting this evening. I was told last week that if the person in the front row prays, nobody else can hear it. So I'm going to ask somebody in the back row to pray. Scotty, would you care to dismiss us in prayer? And Lucy and Kelly, you guys can join me over at the door.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning, Father God, this evening, praise. Father, we thank you for this young lady stepping forward, Father God, and just following you in obedience, Captain. Father, I just thank you for this message that's given us today. Father, I just thank you for each person that's here. I thank you for each visitor that's been here today. Lord, I just ask you to continue to bless us, lead, guide, and direct us, Father, to do throughout the day, throughout our week. Father God, we just thank you for all the things you're doing, all your many blessings you give us. Just lead, guide, direct us. In Christ's name we pray.